Sorry, your name's up.
Hello and welcome, Toastmasters, viewers at home, and guests. It is January 3rd, 2017. A new year has come upon us, a new chance to develop our speaking skills, our leadership skills, and to take our personal development to an unbelievable height that we never imagined we would be able to achieve before. Our pack leader on this trip is our president, Rick Starr.
Thank you, Will. Fellow Golden Speakers, honored guest, viewers at home, welcome to our January 3rd meeting of the Golden Speakers Toastmasters. We meet every Tuesday meeting here at the meeting room in the Hy-Vee supermarket right at the end of the ice cream aisle. I notice we have a guest, special guest. Would you mind standing up and telling us who you are and what brought you to Toastmasters?
Sure. My name's Orion Abrams. My stepdad's Ed Hip. He's a veteran Toastmaster. And I was here as a guest about like 4 or 5 months ago.
I remember you, yeah.
I want to get more into it. It conflicts with my Magic the Gathering card game. Tuesday nights, so I try to come every week. But I'll try and come at least every other week as a guest, and then maybe get be a member in when March when I get back from Australia.
Good. So. Well, welcome.
Thanks.
Glad to have you. And if any of you happen to have a cell phone on you, please turn it off, as I am doing to mine, and so we don't have any interruptions during these speeches. The mission of the Golden Speakers Toastmasters Club is to provide a safe and supportive environment where we can develop our communication skills and our leadership skills in order to gain personal fulfillment and self-confidence. And now I'd like to turn it on. One more thing I wanted to mention for the two speakers who are speaking today. Toastmasters has a tradition of when you speak for a certain length of time, and that's one of the things you learn in Toastmasters, is to tailor your speech to fit in a certain time box. And that's because when you go out into the real world and you're given a speaking role, you're not asked to speak for 15 or 20, 25 minutes, you're given a certain time. So this is what we have here. And what we're going to do is each person is given a speech, say it's 5 to 7 minutes. And at the end of the speech, you have 30 seconds additional. So you have 7.5 minutes. And if 30 seconds after that, so if it's a 7 minute speech, at 8 minutes, the timer will very gently start clapping, which means that's the end of the speech. We don't mean to embarrass you, we don't mean to humiliate you, but we will in order to teach you to speak to a certain length of time. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce the Toastmaster, who's kind of the master of ceremonies, will keep the meeting moving along, Prana Miller.
Thanks. Happy New Year, everybody. This is our first meeting of 2017. It's pretty exciting. The theme of the meeting, actually, on that note, is resolutions. So if you have a New Year's resolution, or you don't, maybe you can work it into your speech somehow, or just reflect on resolutions as you think about the meeting here and do your speeches. So the first thing I'll read the quote. It was always during a passing state of mind that we make lasting revolutions. Resolutions, sorry. It's always during a passing state of mind that we make lasting resolutions, by Marcel Proust. And let's move on with the meeting here. The first thing I would like to do is introduce the evaluator, Jean Symington Craig, who will be evaluating the first speaker tonight, Susanna. She's doing...
Roles,
I'm sorry, yeah. Jumping the gun here. Okay, the first role tonight, the role player, would be on doll, who's the timer. Please give us a report of what you'll be doing.
Oh, good evening, everyone. My role as a timer would be to keep a track of the time of each speaker in the meeting. When you have a green light, it's an indication that for a speaker, I will give a green light when it is 5 minutes, and then a yellow light when it is 6 minutes, and a red light 7 minutes, and you have 30 seconds to round off your speech. And as Rick mentioned, if it goes beyond the next 30 minutes, I would clap. So please watch for the light. Each speaker will have 5 minutes to 7 minutes of their speaking time, and table topic would be 1 to 2 minutes. There'll be a green light at 1 minute, yellow light at 1 minute and 30 seconds, and red at 2 minutes. And speech evaluator will have a time for 2 to 3 minutes, and there'll be a green light at 2 minutes, yellow light at 2 minutes and 30 seconds, and red light at 3 minutes. And general evaluator will have 3 to 4 minutes. There'll be a green light at 3 minutes, yellow light at 3 minutes and 30 seconds, and red light at 4 minutes. And at the end of the meeting, I'll give a report of the meeting time. Thank you.
Perfect. All right. We should all follow Andal's precision in her report. So let's hear from the grammarian for the... Are you able to be the grammarian, Rocco? Are you prepared?
No.
Herman. Oh, Herman, sorry. Where's Herman? No, Herman. Okay, who wants to be a substitute grammarian? I'll be this. Okay, you want to do it? You
can. I have Herman.
It's not my decision.
Be able to prep before you...
I'll be the grammarian. Okay. And so I'll write up a word of the day.
Wait.
I'll be the grammarian.
Okay, great. Rick is the grammarian. Would you like to give a summary of what you'll be doing?
Yes.
Okay.
So there are three or four purposes of the role of the grammarian. One is to listen to the speeches carefully and make note of any good use of the English language. The second is, if you notice any usages of the language that needs improvement, to make that. And at the end of the meeting, give a brief report about what I heard and observed, and to listen and count for the use of the word of the day and report on it at the end of the meeting. Now, the word of the day is... Does anyone have a word of the day? No?
Enthusiasm.
Resolve.
Pithy.
Pithy.
Yeah. What's that even mean?
All right, we'll take the easy way out
and
use the word resolution. Resolution.
It means
New Year's resolution.
Yes. It's like...
So from the Rick Starr Dictionary of the English Language, the definition of resolution is a resolved intent to improve yourself. Thank you.
Okay, so that's the role of the grammarian. Also, during the meeting, we have the awe counter, who will be responsible for keeping track of... Well, actually, Will, tell us what you're going to be doing today.
Thank you, Corona. I kind of feel like you had a pretty good story there yourself, up your sleeve, for my role, but I'll go ahead here. My job as awe counter is to improve your speaking power. If you're going to be giving any kind of taped speech, like a TED Talk or a TV interview or anything like that, don't got to worry about this as much. However, if it's live, you are screwed unless If you have ahs, ums, likes, you knows, sos, buts, ands, tongue clicks, repeats, and false starts. These things will hurt you. And we don't want that at all.
Thank you, Will. That's great. All right. I think we've all heard radio broadcasts where they just destroyed the awe counter. So be aware of the awe counter. Next, I would like to mention that Emery Styron will be giving a general evaluation of the evaluators at the end of the meeting. And let's move forward with the meeting. And Andal is going to have us have some comedy and a joke master at the end of the meeting. Are you ready for that?
She's ready.
She's ready. Okay. All right. We're ready. She's already laughing. That's good. All right. So Andal is the joke master, and I think that's it. So, Jean, please, let's welcome Jean Symington Craig for the first speaker's evaluator introduction. Thanks.
Susanna McCann is going to be speaking from the Competent Communicator Manual project number 5, Your Body Speaks. Her objectives are to use stance, movement, gestures, facial expressions, and eye contact to express her message and achieve her speech's purpose. She also wants to make her body language smooth and natural. Susanna has lived in Fairfield for 30 years. She has a passion for contributing to evolution of human culture, and particularly at this time, restoring masculine-feminine balance in a culture for everyone's greater well-being. The title of her speech is Increasing Balance and Vitality Through the Practice of the Microcosmic Orbit. Sounds good. Please help me warmly welcome Susanna McCann.
It's my pleasure this evening to talk with you about one of my favorite topics. Some of you have heard me speak about various aspects of Taoism and Qigong. Taoism is the ancient system, philosophical, you might say, system of China that corresponds to the ancient Vedic system in India and the Western philosophy, religion, deep values of culture in the West. And one thing I especially like about Taoist Qigong, Taoist system, is that the connection between the individual and the cosmic is very explicit in Taoism. The connection between the universe and the human body is very explicit in Taoism, and it's made practical by the system of Qigong, which is a system of energy. Qigong means energy mastery, and it's a system of subtle exercises, you might say, energy circulation, developing the meridians, the energy flow patterns and pathways in your physiology so that you can handle more cosmic juice, you might say. It's like a way to increase your wiring from 110 to 220. And so the Taoist Qigong system makes use of this connection between individuality in the human body versus universality and the larger world. One of the foundational exercises, you might say, in Qigong is called the microcosmic orbit. And it's very foundational in Qigong, and it's a pathway of energy flow in the body that involves coming down in the front and going up the back and sort of cycling around in this orbit. It can be taught in a very intricate and very detailed way. Many people have spent many lifetimes learning and practicing and going more deeply into the microcosmic orbit. However, for purposes of tonight, we'll just do a little bit of this, and I'll invite some audience participation when we get there. First, in connection with Taoism, many of you probably heard of the energies of yin and yang, right? Yin is the so-called feminine energy. Yang is the so-called masculine energy. And yang tends to be very focused, fiery, quick, and it tends to rise. Yin tends to be a little more grounded, a little more heavy, and it tends to fall. And this is mapped onto the human body. These energies are mapped onto the human body in this microcosmic orbit, in the sense that the yang meridians and the yang energy is seen to go up the back, and the front of the body is considered the feminine side, and the energies tend to go down the front when this orbit is circulating. And on a little bit smaller level, the yang meridians, say in the arm, are on the outside of the arm. The yin meridians are on the inside. So the yang meridians tend to be more focused. For example, the spinal cord goes up through the vertebrae, through the spinal column, and it's protected by this bony sheath. Whereas the vagus nerve system is connected with all the internal organs, all the abdominal, all the torso organs, the heart, everything. And it goes up, the vagus nerve does not go through the spinal column. It goes parallel to the carotid artery and goes into the brain and is related to a different part of the brain. Let's practice a little bit. I invite you to stand up just for a moment and stretch out a little bit. Relax a little bit. Create some space in your body, especially in your spine. Breathe into your spine. Think of each of the little pads between each vertebra as a small balloon that you're blowing up. So you're bringing chi into your spine. And so relax. And what we're going to do is, when a person takes their first breath, the body is filled up and you start living, you know. And so we're going to breathe in to our abdomen and then breathe out through your spine, in a sense. And if you like, you can let your hands follow along to help guide the energy. You come down in the front, breathe out, going up the back. And just from this intention of the mind driving the chi through this orbit, along with the breath, which helps channel the energy, you can get a feeling for this microcosmic orbit. Now be still for a minute and do it in a more subtle way. Just breathing in, relaxing, opening, taking in life, and then breathing out. So the opposites of yin and yang are associated with the opposites of masculine and feminine, the opposites of the higher values, quote unquote, and the lower values. The head represents the heavens, the abdomen represents the earth, And we integrate all these values in the microcosmic orbit. Thank you.
Okay. I was thinking the evaluator is going to come talk to you, but sorry. Great speech. All right. All right. Next up, we have
2 minutes.
2 minutes. That's what I was going to say. I'm going to say that. 2 minutes to evaluate Susanna's speech. We're back. Let's welcome Dan Craig to introduce the next speaker.
Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, honored guests, viewers at home. Tonight we're going to hear from Marko Janic. He's going to be doing project number 4, How to Say It. Let me first read the objectives of the project, and then I'll read a bit more about Marko. For this project, the objectives are, first, to select the right words and sentence structure to communicate your ideas clearly, accurately, and vividly. Use rhetorical devices to enhance and emphasize ideas. Eliminate jargon and unnecessary words. Use correct grammar. Marko Janic was born in Belgrade, Serbia in 1990. In high school, he finished with a diploma in ecology. After that, he finished the Forestry University with a bachelor's degree in environmental engineering. He moved to the U.S. with his family in 2012. In July, he stayed for 3 months and went back to Serbia to finish the last year of college, and then came back again to the U.S. in November 2013. After that, he worked in a casino for a year, where he saw the other side of the coin. A year ago, he decided to further his education and find out about MUM, decided to come and visit January 2016, and he came back for school in August. Now he works as director of MUM Recreation Center full-time, while he studies for an MBA part-time. Marko is passionate about growth, living the life to the fullest potential, exploring martial arts education, helping people, and public speaking. Please welcome Marko.
Fellow members, Toastmasters, guests, and viewers at home, thank you. Today I would like to talk about the subject that I think it's really important and necessary for every living organism on this planet, and that is water. First, before I start talking, I would like to ask you, start with the interaction, what is it water represent for you? Can somebody tell me? What does water represent for you? Does anybody can tell me what is it?
Life.
That's great. Exactly. That we all agree that without water, there is no life on this planet. And we all agree that all the people who search for some life on different planet, they first search for the water on this planet. But yes, we know that water contains from one atom of oxygen to atoms, hydrogen, but actually, what is the water? Where is it coming from? Do we really know what is the water? This is my question. And it's such an intricate thing for me. It is that even though you use it every day for drinking, for shower, for everyday activity, for cooking, eating, do we really know what is it? What is the water? And how valuable it is in our life? A couple years ago, I had a privilege while I was in college. My teacher played a movie about the water, a documentary about the water. I didn't know anything about at the time I didn't watch documentaries and know anything about development and any of that, but he played a movie about the water and it was really interesting that scientists from all over the world were doing the research about the water. And it was really one really interesting experiment. Dr. Emoto, Japanese scientist, 1999, he did the research on the water where he studied and do microscopic research of the molecules of the water. And he will do expose the water to different things, different musics, different environments. And he will then freeze the water and do the scientific research of the molecules of the water and see that depending on the environment where the water is, the molecular structure of the water is different. And if the water is exposed to some nice, beautiful music, like classic music, Mozart, the structure of the water it's like crystals, it's like a snowflake. It's really beautiful. But if it's some like hard rock music or something that's stressful, then the all the molecules of water break. It's like killing the water. What they discovered was really interesting for me, that the water is have a memory in itself. Everything that we say or do, it's just receiving the energy. Like Suzanne was mentioning about energy, yin and yang, I understand that everything is the energy and the water is also energy. And the energy as itself, it's part of us. And we are that energy. 80% of us is water, 70 to 80% of us is water. But what is interesting for me is that they scientifically have proven that water have the memory, and everything that we say and emotions and feelings they imply to the water, it affects it and defines the structure of the water. And we are the water, we are 80% of the water. And all the thoughts, emotions that we imply to somebody else or somebody else implies us, affects us. Everything is so interconnected. But further than that, I didn't believe it. It was like, okay, that's blah, blah, blah. But I saw they were doing some experiment. I say, I wanna do this experiment. I take three glass jars, and I fill them with the rice. And I put the water in all of them, all three of them. And on one jar, I wrote love. The other jar, I just didn't wrote in the middle jar, I didn't wrote anything. And the third jar, I write all the bad words, like hate, anger, like bad words. And I will put that in one room separate from everybody. Like nobody will go to that room. And then I will go every day and spend some time in that room. And one jar, the first jar that I will send all the good emotions. I said, you're my love, you're so beautiful, I love you, and all the good emotions. The middle jar, I will ignore. I wouldn't look at it, I wouldn't anything, just like despise. And the third jar, I will say all the bad words. You're ugly, you're everything. I hate you, and all the bad words I could remember at that time. And I was doing that, I didn't see much change. But after a week, my mother asked me, because she knew she was thinking I'm crazy what I was doing. She asked me, what is going on with these jars? And then I went upstairs and saw they all three jars were totally different. It was the same rice, the same water, and all three jars had a different structure inside of them. And I couldn't believe. I said to myself, oh my God, this is true. The one that I was applying the love, it was so beautiful, it was like crystal clear. The one in the middle, it was like foggy, and the third one, the one that I ignore and the one that I hate, send the hate, it was the worst. There was a little difference, but the third one that I was sending, the first one that I was sending love, it was totally different than the second two. And it was amazing. For me, that was epiphany. That was a resolution at that time for me that I said to myself, now from every time I'm going to wash my face, drink a glass of water, I'm going to send a blessing to it. Because that's me, that's who I am. I have to send blessing not only to the water I drink, I have to send blessing to myself every day. Because I realized that, and as I learned from the movie as well, that the molecular structure of the water is much more important than the chemical structure of the water. And now we know from all that's going on, we had to pay for the water. Before the time when I was even came here to this planet in this physical form, the water was free and it was in abundance for everyone. But now, not so much. And the scarcity of water is even more and more. That's why we have to be more appreciative and send blessing to it and really, really value the most valuable things in our lives. Thank you.
Take 2 minutes to. We're back. Let's now move on to the next section of our meeting, which will be table topics. And it's the impromptu part of the meeting, so let's welcome the table topics. Let's vote the best speaker first. Anybody, does all of our speakers qualify?
Marco qualified,
okay. I had an intuitive hunch. Okay, so we don't have to vote for best speaker. Let's move on to the next portion of our meeting. Emery Styron will be the general evaluator of the next portion of our meeting to introduce the table topics. I'm totally off. Hold on, let me introduce Emery Styron, who will be leading the next portion of the meeting. Okay.
Thank you and good evening, fellow Toastmasters, two guests, viewers at home. Let me introduce our first evaluator, Jean Symington Craig, who will evaluate Susanna.
Yes.
Fellow Toastmasters, guests, and viewers at home, and especially Susanna. Susanna's project is to learn how to move and use gestures. I'm going to follow the criteria in the manual and give some comments. So her topic selection, I said it did facilitate body language. She was showing us things have to do with the body. Now, I talked to her ahead of time and I said I wanted to see gestures and movement, not just in the actual subject matter she was doing, but also when she's just talking, because that's where you want to learn how to use gestures, whether you're telling a story or whatever you're doing. But I thought it was a good talk for this project. Her preparation, I put it as satisfactory, and the reason I put that was that I felt that it ended a little bit abruptly, and so I would have liked to have a little more preparation that would have manifested as a conclusion that worked in and then still be within the timing of the speech. Her manner, she seemed very confident and enthusiastic to me. Her posture, she very poised and balanced. Her gestures, I did like the gestures that she used outside of where she was actually showing as gestures. She was doing universe and then body, and she was doing some things with her hands that I wanted to see. So that was a good thing to do. Could also have gotten a little bit more into this territory and then bigger up here. That's the next level of gestures, not just in this zone here, but good, it was good. Body movement, I thought she was purposeful and smooth. Eye contact, I saw her establishing eye contact with people. Facial expression, she seemed animated, friendly, enjoying what she's talking about. Her speech purpose was clear. She wanted to tell us about this microcosm orbit. Is that right? Microcosm orbit. Her speech organization, a suggestion there was to have a three-part structure. I was writing it down. She started out, what is the microcosmic orbit? And then the yin and the yang around that. And maybe the yin and the yang was the second part of it. But I'm just going to say the microcosmic orbit and then the yin and the yang I had as one point. The second part of it was having everybody stand up, audience participation, practice. That was good. A third part could be, just to round it out, and you have to get it all in your time, would be the the like a, as an option could be, what are the benefits that we can expect to have after in our daily life? What is that going to feel like? You know, not as much chest pounding, more, not as much, you know, whatever that is. Okay, so basically add another little point in there is what I would suggest, and then have a conclusion. They could just wrap it up, each of those three points quickly. What I've said is that, go out and enjoy, and go see, find a class. So what I really liked about her speech was that she really seemed credible. She seemed to really understand and know what she's talking about. I felt comfortable that what I was getting was factual information from experience. Just would encourage her to continue giving speeches, and looking forward to the next one.
Thank you. Thank you, Jane.
It's always a pleasure to watch a skilled evaluator at work. My resolution is to grow up and be like Jean as an evaluator. And for our next evaluation, I'd like to call up Dan Craig to evaluate Marco. Thank you, Mr. General Evaluator. My resolution is to grow up and be like Jean also. Now for the evaluation of Marco's speech. What was your full title? I just wrote down water.
Yeah.
Okay, water, that was clear. I'm just gonna go through the points in the manual and make comments at the items that are asked. It asks us first, was the speech topic appropriate for this project? Yes, very much so. It was a fascinating subject that you were very interested in. Did the speaker use simple, short, clear words? Yes, I thought that was true. Did the speaker use vivid, descriptive words that created mental images? This was really a strong point, I thought. When you describe to us the ways that water is affected by different kinds of music or different emotions directed toward it, you painted some word pictures for us and you conveyed to us what those structures might look like. Did the speaker use words that had more than one meaning? I didn't think so. Were the speaker's sentences short, simple, and understandable? I thought perhaps that could have improved, though I'm afraid I don't have a specific example to give you. That was just an overall impression. Did the speaker use rhetorical devices to enhance his or her ideas? I may have missed what you used, but I didn't hear any. Things like alliteration or similes or metaphors, colorful ways to phrase things, which is this project was calling for. Was jargon and necessary words avoided? Yes. Did the speaker use proper grammar and pronunciation? At some points, there were a few things that could have been fine-tuned. For example, I was hearing the phrase towards the beginning of the speech, I believe you were saying, what is the water? We're trying to determine what is the water. And it seemed to be, the way I would have said it, would be what the water is. That's the way my brain works. Was speech purpose clear? Yes. Was it effectively organized? Yes, though I think the one improvement would have been in regards to the conclusion. I really liked your introduction. Very good. You said, tonight I'm going to talk to you about water. Immediately we knew where we were. I liked your points. Very interesting stuff. At the end, I believe you just said that now that you know these things about water, that you always feel how blessed you are at each time that you interact with it. I think you could have done a little bit of a recap for us of the content of your speech as part of that conclusion, which would have made it stronger. What could a speaker have done to make the speech more effective? I thought your speaking volume could be a little higher. You have good vocal variety. You have soft passages, you have louder passages. In this room particularly, your volume needs to go up a little bit. I also noticed that your hand gestures are a little constrained. You
we're tending to do this quite a bit. But it's actually the next speech, which is your body speaks. So that's where you look at that. What did you like about the speech? I enjoyed the word pictures that you painted about water under different conditions. I liked your enthusiasm and that conveyed to us your joy and awe about our interactions with water. Thank you.
Thank you, Glenn.
Now come to the table topics portion of the meeting. I'd like to call up our table topics master, Art Atkinson. Thank you, Art.
Thank you, Emery. Good evening, fellow Toastmasters. This quote of ours, the quote from Marcel Proust, it is always during a passing state of mind that we make lasting resolutions. This is such an unusual statement. And resolution is such a rich, there's such a rich constellation of words around resolution. There's resolve, there's resolute. And resolution itself has a half a dozen different meanings in different contexts. Who would like to be the first person? Orion. Yes, come, join us.
Can I put this here so I don't have to hold it for my speech? I made that today. Is that okay? It's my new motto.
Very good.
Magic and balance.
Okay. Tell us about the most valuable resolution that you have ever made.
Say the already did an counter. Damn it! I've been living with bipolar disorder for the last 11 years, and I've been hospitalized for mania 5 times, and the last time was a couple years ago. I was hospitalized for 6 months. So I have a lot of experience with bipolar disorder and mania and depression, anxiety, paranoia, mental illness type stuff. So the most important New Year's resolution I'd have to say was probably this year. I decided that I want to be more balanced in my body and in my mind. That's why I painted this today. This is my new motto, magic and balance. So it was going to be magic with balance or magic through balance or magic from balance, but all those make it seem like magic only happens when you have balance, but I think magic can happen without balance. So I'd like to be able to live life, live the magic and the joy and the excitement of life, and have have balance with that. So magic and balance. So that was my New Year's resolution. I didn't realize it was my New Year's resolution. And going along with what the quote that you said, that it's always a passing experience that creates a lasting resolution. I feel like I had quite a few passing experiences around Christmas, and also my passing mania experiences. I feel like around Christmas, also one thing I smoked a hit of pot. That was like a passing experience for a few hours. But that kind of expanded my consciousness too, and I kind of had some interesting insights. I had like a manic flashback from that, and then I also drank a bunch of beer, and I was fine after a couple of days, but it was kind of intense. Anyway, it looks like the red light's on, so that's my field talk.
Thank you. Who else? volunteer there, we have a volunteer here, and we have an encouragement going on. Okay, Emery?
Okay, all right.
Did you ever make a memorable, important resolution at an other time of the year in the New Year's? And if so, tell us about it.
Fellow Toastmasters, guests, viewers at home. I normally make New Year's resolutions, and I don't believe that I make many other than at New Year's. And I don't tend to always keep what I make, as I think is the case with most people. But I do think the theme of the meeting is a good one. It is always during a passing state of mind that we make lasting resolutions. And I don't know how lasting this one will be, but my wife said something to me today. We dropped off my car for an oil change at the mechanic, and we were coming back to the house and pulled into the garage. And she said she had read a quote which said, life is simple. It is the projections that we put on it that makes it complicated. Which reminded me of my resolution this year was simply to remember to breathe when I eat. the most basic life processes, but I managed to mess those up. And my green light's on, but also I'll tell you quickly, maybe because I've had nasal obstruction, I've always been a mouth breather rather than a nose breather, and it causes problems when I eat because I forget to breathe and then I start gasping. So I'm trying to keep life simple. Take a bite, breathe, chew, repeat. Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster.
Okay, next volunteer. Rick, are you still up for the game?
Yeah.
I have one for you that I hope you'll enjoy.
I hope I will too.
Did you ever help adversaries achieve resolution of a dispute? That could be in a family context, a work context, a sports context. Any kind of context where there was people at loggerheads, did you help them achieve resolution of that dispute?
A different use of the word resolution. Funnily enough, as part of my job as kind of a project manager working with different individuals and different teams, I am tasked with bringing resolutions to a successful conclusion. And most of the time, Emery mentioned that life is simple, it's all about the projections we place upon it that make it complicated. And resolutions, the actual differences are often very simple. It's often the emotional impact it has on people. So I've been doing this for a while. I'm taking a course now. It's a 6-month course to become a registered corporate coach. It doesn't mean I coach corporations, it means I coach within the context of work, and that's very interesting. So I have had a lot of experience dealing with resolving issues between people. Just going back to the other resolution, I was just thinking of how over the many years I've made resolutions, how many times I've been successful in keeping them, and I've totaled them up and the total comes to zero. I've never been successful in keeping any resolution. Resolutions, I've always picked lofty goals, and they've always been very difficult and very, and I've never been able to do it. To make it easier on myself this year, I picked two pet resolutions, which I think I can accomplish. I've decided to start smoking and gain weight. Thank you.
Three cheers for that. Are you ready to join the speakers?
Yeah.
Okay, now, you don't have to be on that side. You could be over here if you like, speak from wherever you like. Does your camera on your phone or any other camera you have take high resolution photos? Tell us about a high resolution photo that you particularly enjoy, that's a favorite photograph that you've taken.
Okay, that got me.
Okay.
It has,
if you'd like to talk about any of the other questions that I asked, would you like to tell us about a favorite resolution that you've made that was important to you?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, very good.
So just last year, last New Year, I decided to read one book per month and then write the review of the book at the end of the month. So first few months I was doing okay, but after that I somehow felt forced into doing it, because I wrote it down in a piece of paper that I was going to do it, so I had to do it. And then I stopped enjoying reading books, because I was doing it because I had to do it. And every other month I would enjoy it more less than the other month. And then I completely stopped because I was forcing myself into doing it. So that continued for about 8 months. And at the end of the 8 months, I made another resolution that I will stop forcing myself into doing things, even if I write down it into a piece of paper. So that has been working out quite well for me.
Subhecha.
Okay,
we got
that. Thank you. Let's check the time.
Get one more.
Is there time for one more?
One more.
Who would like to?
One more.
I'll do it.
Don't listen.
No, we want everybody to have a chance to speak this evening. Anyone who hasn't spoken, would like to? Okay, Santoria, are you up for it?
Santoria. I'll speak for Santoria.
Jean.
You appoint me?
She's going to channel Santoria.
I'm good. Oh, that's impossible.
Okay.
I'll be proxy. Oh, yeah.
So two of them have brought up the subject of New Year's resolutions, or resolutions that you didn't follow through on. Are you part of that camp? Have you ever been in that situation? You made a resolution and you're not following through on it? If so, tell us about it.
Thank you. Fellow Toastmasters, first of all, I'm going to give you my strategy of how I handle resolutions. My birthday is January 26th. I always feel like I have a little fudge time. If I don't quite get it right out of the gate after New Year's Eve, I figure, you know, birthday, I can start it up again. So I do a little bit of a dry run, first 3 weeks of January to see how it feels, get my legs, and then, boom, my birthday is when I put it into play. That's my general approach. Now I'll tell you about one that I've worked on, and actually this is where it's good to have a life partner, because there's some things that you set out to do and you realize really it's better to work from your own strengths and have somebody else work from their strengths. My husband Dan is an accountant. I am not. So one of my resolutions would be to, this year I'm going to get a budget. I'm going to get stuff organized. People talk about how important it is, and you figure out what your expenses are, and then you look at it and you keep it all together, and it just bores me to tears. It just bores me to tears. But I recognize it's needed, because when the money runs out, that's no fun either. Okay. That's where you have a partner comes in. Sits down, gets the spreadsheets out, asks the questions, pulls the things together. I just answer questions, and then it pops into some format, and there we go. So I recommend, if you're having trouble keeping resolutions, don't keep beating yourself up, as this young lady said. Find somebody else who'll do it for you. Keep them in your life, and then it's a win-win situation. Thank you.
In some circles, that's called getting an accountability partner. Okay. Where are we at time-wise, Mr. Toastmaster? Are we still blessed with time to do table topic?
No, we're done.
We're done. Okay. Mr. General Evaluator.
Straight orders from the...
Ask who's the... who qualified.
Mr. Timer, would you tell us who qualified as a table topic speaker?
All the speakers qualified for table topic. For evaluator, Jean
qualified.
What?
Our table topic speakers are Orion, and Rick.
Could you say their names, please?
Oh, yeah. The table topic speakers are Orion, Emery, Rick Starr, Sweeksha, and Jean. Sweeksha.
So, now to vote.
Our table topic speakers. It takes a lot of courage from us. Especially guests and first timers. Yes, thank you, Art. Orion, you were speaking about the most valuable resolution. First off, the visual aid was a first. I don't think I've ever seen a visual aid for a table topics. I loved it. Thank you for doing that. You spoke about a very personal and important discussion. You started us off here about bipolar disorder, and you started by establishing your own credentials as somebody qualified to speak on this topic. It was a really powerful table topic, so I was really into it, into what you had to say next. My only suggestion for you would be to note that we love stories. I would have loved a story about your experiences while high, your adventures while drunk, or how magic, tired. Yeah, I know, it's crazy, or how magic does balance it. I hope you do become a Toastmaster, and I would love to hear stories from you about that, or something else. Emery, keeping life simple. I liked your quote about dropping off the car and your wife turning to you and saying, life is simple, but it's the projections that make it complex. Kind of paraphrasing a little bit there. My suggestion for you would be just to, you kind of had your hands clapped a little bit, I would say just bring it out, because you are an amazing speaker. You're very evocative. You're great with words. Use the gestures there to bring that out. Capture our attention. Rick, resolving conflict. You spoke about your job as a product manager at Cambridge and about becoming a corporate coach. My suggestion for you would be, there's Rick. been talking about resolutions and having no luck at keeping them, I would recommend that when you want to go out of your old phase into your new, take a step from the left to the right. I'm going to start smoking, and I'm going to start gaining weight. Which actually is very difficult if you're doing those two things both at the same time, from what I understand. Subiksha, the important resolution to read one book a month and then review it at the end. You spoke about the pain of doing this and how you took your own destiny in your hands and resolved to stop doing this after 8 months, a full 4 months before you otherwise us mere mortals would have done. My advice is the same as with Rick. You're tired of all this BS with these books. You're gonna move. I will have more respect for myself, for my time, and for my own experiences. I will go out there and do what I want to do. Finally, Jean, fudge time. You spoke about January being a dry run, a chance just to come out here and just test things. About budgeting and spreadsheets, how much they are a bore, make you cry, which is ironic how opposites attract. My suggestion is, this is an important man in your life. When the time comes, reach out to him and say, this man saves me from myself. Or something. Thank you all for your... And vice versa.
Madam Timer, can you tell us which evaluators qualified? Okay, well, we'll just skip right over the voting for best evaluator. Congratulations, Jean. And now it's time for reports. Madam Timer, can you give us a timer's report? Please give us a timer's report.
Good evening, everyone, once again. Our speaker, Susanna, spoke for 7 minutes and 34 seconds. Marco spoke for 7 minutes and 13 seconds. Table topics, Orion spoke for 2 minutes and 24 seconds. Emery, 1 minute and 55 seconds. Rick Star, 1 minute and 46 seconds. Subiksha, 1 minute and 10 seconds. Jean, 2 minutes and 3 seconds. As evaluator's time, Jean, 3 minutes and 30 seconds. Dan, 3 minutes and 55 seconds. Wells, 3 minutes and 31 seconds. Thank you. That's the time.
Thank you. You're Mary and Rick.
Very precise.
Thank you, Mr. General Evaluator, fellow speaker, fellow Toastmasters, and viewers at home. Had some very interesting uses of language. Susanna, I think, summarized their hard talk on this yin and yang represent the feminine and the masculine. Marco said water has a memory. Also, when he was talking about the experiment, he said it was an epiphany, a realization that he came to. One suggestion, I think sometimes you said the water and sometimes you said water. I think in most cases, water would have been appropriate. Just a subtle distinction there. Orion, congratulations on your table topics. I thought it was a very courageous thing to do, to speak about yourself that way. You said you want to live magic, joy, and the excitement of life, and we wish that for you too. Emery's resolution was a little more low-key. He wanted to be able to continue to breathe while he was eating. Subiksha, you wrote it down and you felt obligated to do it because you had written down and that somehow sealed it. But later on, you resolved not to do something you didn't want to do, even though you had written it down. And Jean, I'm paraphrasing here, but the key to success of a happy marriage is if you can't budget find a partner who can and stick with him. Thank you. Oh, one more thing, forgot the word of the day, because it was part of the table topics. Everyone who did table topics used it, and Art was the winner. He said it 128 times.
And Marco used it in his talk.
Marco used it in his talk.
All right.
Andal, are you ready with a joke?
I take the resolution to present a funny joke in front of you. The bill goes to visit his uncle, rich uncle, for Christmas break. And while he was playing, he accidentally breaks a beautiful vase at his house. And uncle, he comes angrily and he's like, "What did you do to my vase?" He yells at him. And this boy, he's so scared, standing there. "Oh my God, what did I do?" He tells him, like, "Do you know how old it is? It's from 17th century." He goes, sagging with relief, "Oh my God, that's okay, good. I thought it was new."
Thank you.
And now, finally, it's my turn to evaluate the evaluators.
What about the
awe
counter?
The awe counter?
Will.
Will. Okay, I jumped the gun. I wanted to talk so badly.
I'll make it brief. Just for fun, I'll go from top to bottom here. Subiksha had three repeats. Orion, three uhs. I think they're uhs. Emery, one and. Marco, two us, one one and, one repeat, three false start. Susanna, one so, two and, one false start. Jean, three us, three sos, one and, two repeats, one false start. Fana, one so, one and.
Thank you. A record lightning all counters report.
Yeah.
My job to evaluate the evaluators and make a general comment or two on the meeting. Jean, evaluating. Oh, come on.
Susanna,
right. I like that Jean had talked with Susanna before her speech. That's something a lot of us don't do, but it's good, you find out things you specifically would like your evaluator to watch for. Jean went through the manual. She gave specific examples of good gestures and examples of how to take those to the next level, wider use of hands and so on. And she gave a good suggestion on three-point structure. A suggestion for Jean: lose the coat. You did that in your table topics, but it just, I don't know, maybe it's just me, but it just makes me feel like somebody's not really completely here if they don't take their coat off. Had that problem with kids at the dinner table. All right, Dan. Read the objectives. The introduction was a little long. I think you could have squeezed that up a little bit. Marco is the main show. Good point by point in the manual. You gave specific descriptions of vivid descriptive words, and you were supportive and complimentary, but you did not let Marco off too easy. You gave some fair criticism about the use of literary devices. Or lack of a suggestion on a stronger speech structure. Suggestion for you: you were mostly talking to Marco, and include all of us, and you did, both of you finished with compliments, which was good. Will, good praise and suggestions for each person as you evaluated table topics. You move very freely up here, but sometimes it seems almost a little aimless. So make it more purposeful. That is my evaluation. I'd like to call our Toastmaster Craig back to
you. Thank you. Thanks, Rick. We are coming to the close quite early tonight, first change. I'd like to give all the awards for the speakers in this meeting. So, quite a few. First, I'd like to give an award out to the winner of the speaker? What was it again? One qualified, right? Just Susan? Okay.
Marco.
Okay. So Marco, let's welcome Marco to the stage for winning the best speaker. Alright, best speaker. And you also get your, how to say it, number four. Yes. And also we have, I'd like to award number five, Your Body Speaks, to Susanna. Hold on. Thanks, Susanna. Thank you. Yes, and the best evaluator, we already, there's no drum roll, we know, Jean Symington Craig, always winning something. Great job. All right. One more shake. Got a good flash on there?
Got it.
All right, okay. Fantastic. And the last, I'm gonna keep you in suspense for a short. You might be Jean, Symington Craig, best table topics. Okay. All right. We gotta do another, but you just want $1 million. The awards section of the meeting. I'd like to welcome Rick Starr to complete the meeting with any closing comments. And come up here. Thanks, Rick.
Thank you, Prana.
All right. Thank you.
And thank you all for attending on this bitterly cold night. Appreciate you braving the weather to come to our meeting. And we had a couple of guests. Ryan, would you like to tell us one thing you enjoyed about this Toastmasters meeting?
Yeah. I liked the laughs. Some of the speeches were really funny. Some of the parts of them were really funny. And the joke. And I just liked laughing. It's good to laugh.
Good. Yeah. Thank you. Mr. Dixon, would you like to tell us one thing you liked about Toastmasters?
I wasn't planning to speak at all, but when I was here, I felt very encouraged watching everyone speak. So
good. Good. Thank you. And you're both more than welcome to visit us at any time. Generally, we have kind of a retro by the president of any things that can be improved, but I was just enjoying the meeting. I didn't notice anything, and I really appreciate you coming out. Really appreciate you being a part of Toastmasters. And any other business? Yes, Jean.
Maybe you might want to just tell the club, since we have a couple extra minutes, what we have accomplished with the Distinguished Club program.
Good point. Every Toastmasters awards clubs for the success of their members. And what that means, if there's certain criteria, but if a certain number of members get the Competent Communicator Award, get the Competent Leader Award, get advanced awards, if we gain more members into our club, then there are various levels of
what's called distinguished clubs that the club can be awarded. There's the distinguished club, there's the president's club, and what's the other one?
President's distinguished.
Select distinguished.
Right. So you've got the right person to explain this up here. There's the select, distinguished, and president's distinguished.
And ribbons.
And so let me get to that.
Okay.
And so this year we've received the president's distinguished award, or we will receive that. In fact, we've received it early enough. The Toastmaster year is only a half over. Only one half over, it goes from June to July, then we may have qualified for this special award as being the first club within the district to receive the President's Distinguished Club Award earliest. Yes?
Who's the president of Toastmasters in the U.S. or whatever? Is there a president for the whole?
There is a president, and does anyone know his name?
From that president, so if you were.
Well, the award comes from our district, and our district is the state of Iowa, more or less, and so every year the district awards that. And as Art pointed out, we have won the President's Distinguished Award many, many years, and we've also won this special lectern with our name engraved or emblazoned on the front, which we're in the process of picking up. And I hope this doesn't sound like bragging, and I feel it doesn't, because it really reflects on the members. If the members of the club are successful in achieving their goals, then the club would be successful. And we have a couple of members here, Santoria and Andal, who helped us receive that by getting their competent communicator award. So I feel proud, but I feel more proud of our members, and thank you all. Any other business? Thank you for coming. I declare the meeting adjourned.